This sermon this morning is dealing with everyday Christian living. And it deals with an area in which many times we may not think that much about, although I think for the genuinely faithful member of the Lord's church we do. Because all around us today is every kind of worldliness, and it's all being promoted, and more people involve themselves in it. As a greater part of our society is more ignorant of the Bible than ever before. And that means then that the church, being in the world, is all too often, at least through certain members, yielding to worldliness of various descriptions. I want you, if you will, read with me to read Ephesians chapter 5, verses 3 through 7. Ephesians 5, 3 through 7. Remembering that this is a letter that makes up part of the New Testament of the Christ that the Apostle Paul wrote to the church in Ephesus concerning Christian living, being godly, being faithful to the Lord as a member of His church. And it deals directly with worldliness that was so common in the first century and becomes more common every day we live here. He writes, "But fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, let it not be once named among you, as becometh saints. And neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor jesting, which are not convenient, but rather giving of thanks. For this ye know, that no whoremonger, nor unclean person, nor covetous man, who is an idolater, hath any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no man deceive you with vain words. For because of these things cometh the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. Be not ye therefore meaning in the light of what I just told you, partakers with them." As I said before I read this passage of Ephesians 5, 3 through 7, what we read here is characteristic of so much that goes on in the United States, whether it's in school, the workplace, government, certainly entertainment. It leads the way. But it's just everywhere. And I'd like to emphasize that we're going to look specifically at verse number four. Now, the context in which, as you well note, verse 4 resides is within a discussion of abstinence from sexual temptations. Fornication refers to any consummate sexual act outside of the marriage bond. Let me emphasize here, that's just not what anybody calls marriage, but it's what God calls marriage, such as is Matthew 19, verse 6, a God-joined marriage between a man and a woman who are eligible to engage in that marriage. And when you look at Matthew 19, 9, you see that there is only, besides death, one reason to dissolve a Matthew chapter 19, verse 6, God-joined marriage. And that's when one of the marriage partners commits fornication. And then the innocent party may put that one away. That is, divorce the one guilty of committing fornication. I want to say something here about the New King James Version, because fornication is not there. It says sexual immorality. But you got to realize sexual immorality can cover a number of things we just read about in verses 3 through 7. You can be involved in a number of kinds of sexual immorality without engaging in fornication. My estimate, it's a poor translation, because you can be engaged in a number of things such as pornography, and that does not, although it's sin and will cause you to lose your soul, but it doesn't serve as a reason for dissolving a marriage. It may lead up to fornication, but all sexual immorality is not fornication, though it be sin. Uncleanness refers to acts which are less than fornication, but still sexual in nature. That's how God views those things. And I'm interested in how God views it. I'm not interested in how academia views it. Or I'm not interested in how the government views it. Or how other men view it. I want to know what God's good word said, because I'll stand before Jesus in judgment to give account of my life in the light of what the New Testament of Christ says. Our Lord said, "He that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words hath one that judgeth him. The words that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day." And we have our Lord's last will and testament in words where we can, if we study with the right disposition of mind, learn exactly how He wants us to live our lives. And if somebody says, "Well, I don't know the New Testament's given to teach us how to live our lives," then you haven't read it very much. And you may not believe it is the will of God, but it is His last will and testament. In other words, it's the last word of Christ on how He wants His members of His church to conduct themselves, teaching also, of course, to those out in the world how to become Christians. Notice that covetousness in this context, in this environment, this literary environment, refers to thoughts and lusts regarding uncleanness, as well as, of course, fornication. It all has to deal with immorality. Now, in the Ten Commandments of the Law of Moses, the very first thing that is forbidden is to covet one's neighbor's wife. Exodus 20 and verse 17. Such things have always been a problem among mankind. And as churches of our Lord cease to set out the strictness of God's infallible word, and because we are in a sewer of immorality surrounding us, then you can just expect a great many people in the church to be guilty of sins of immorality. Add to that the internet and you've just got a mess. Best way to describe it. Covetousness can, in the light of what we've seen, therefore have reference to sexual desire as well as desire for physical things. And this context surely bears it out. Subsequent to the Bible text under study, we have a repetition of the same warnings regarding fornication, uncleanness, and we've seen how the Bible defines uncleanness, and covetousness. Many times we may not use the word covetousness, having reference to sexual desires or things of an immoral nature, but yet we see here it did. Those who practice such things, to put it simply, will not inherit the kingdom of God. It's impossible for them to be a part of the kingdom of God in serving God faithfully. It has no part of the Christian life. It is a transgression of God's law. It's sin. For that is what sin is, 1 John 3, verse 4. And we dare not get ourselves involved in that, nor those things that solicit us to get involved in it. Those who practice such things deserve the wrath of Almighty God. That's what Paul said. If he's inspired of the Holy Spirit, writing part of the New Testament of Christ, you now know the will of Christ if you didn't before on these matters. This is important to us as the church in our being faithful to preach the gospel to every preacher. People must understand, if they're going to be Christians, as the New Testament defines and uses that word Christian, a member of the church, I say the same thing again, as the New Testament defines and uses the word church, are going to have to realize they have to live a certain kind of life. They have to be willing to sacrifice a great many things. Sacrifice meaning something very important to us, but we must give it up in order to please God. Because everywhere you look round about us, even many churches, just simply lower the standard. The more people involve themselves and love it, then people will lower the standard so they can keep those people. But it doesn't change God's standard. And God's faithful people must not lower God's standard. Now, we can among us, but God's not going to. On the day of judgment, He'll call us back to give an account of the deeds done in the body, whether good or bad, on the basis of His standard. The world may have rejected for thousands of years His standard. But when He comes back, The world is destroyed and all material things therein by the fires that God shall set forth upon it. Then when the judgment day comes and all men come before the judgment seat of Christ, his standard will be there. Those who practice such things are simply partakers with the people of the world, the children of disobedience. I don't know why anyone, having from the heart obeyed that form of doctrine, the gospel of Christ, God's power to save us, Romans 1:16 and Romans 6:17 and 18, would want to turn around and say, well, I'm going to live just like the world I'm supposed to have left. Why not just stay in the world? We have a great many people today, some in the church, and a lot of preachers and elders who have just simply in various places in their mind saying, well, it's, you know, God's grace will cover it. God's favor that no man can merit and no man deserves ever condones willful sin where people don't care what the Word of God said. Remember, the law came by Moses. But grace, listen, and truth came by Jesus Christ. The truth of God is that which sets forth the favor of God, as well as how to enter into that favor of God. And that must be kept in mind. When you look at the plan of salvation, having believed in Christ, the next step, Acts 17:30, which commands it, says one must repent. Repentance means that there is a disposition of the heart that says, I've been involved in these things that I now know are contrary to God's will. And I'm not going to follow those things any longer. I don't care how much I've been attached to them before this. I'm giving them up. I'm turning away from them. From henceforth, I will obey God no matter what the situation is. So we can't just say, well, that's my job, or that's what my family's always done. We must say, what is the will of heaven set out in the words of God? For all scripture are given by inspiration of God and are profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect. And that means spiritually complete. That he might be perfect, truly furnished unto every good work. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17 again. So it's important we understand that, and what I read to you is from that divine volume instructing on us what not to do in this case. Now, I know a lot of people say, well, I don't like negative this. Well, you've just been negative when you said that, so why don't you not like yourself? You will find that people who think this way are always engaging in that which they condemn. It's just that if it fits their way of doing things, it's all right to do that. Well, the Lord is telling us here, you live this way, you will not go to heaven. That's clear, isn't it? If you practice these things, you will not go to heaven, whether you're outside the church and never become a Christian, or whether you're in the church and decide to live this way. So the Christian is admonished not to be a part of this type of thinking, or hold that kind of state of mind, or that mentality, we might want to call it. Now, sandwiched in between these two stern condemnations of sexual avarice, we find a rebuke regarding a specific kind of speech as well. And sometimes reading this, we don't realize what we've done because we're concentrating on those things I just mentioned. But I mention it now after we set the very context or the environment in which it is found. The King James Version reads, neither filthiness nor foolish talking nor jesting, which are not convenient, but rather giving of thanks. Now, what did he mean there? Well, he's simply saying it in another way. Let there be no filthiness, nor foolish talk, nor crude joking, which are out of place. But instead, let there be thanksgiving. Now you're seeing why the Lord said, by thy words thou shalt be justified. By thy words thou shalt be condemned. And here's instruction by the peerless apostle to the Gentiles, Paul, inspired of the Holy Spirit, writing part of the New Testament of the Christ telling us this very thing. The word filthiness is a translation of a word that some scholars say is limited to speech. But of course, what we say comes through our minds, and out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. This is the only place where this word is found in the New Testament, and it is within the context of speech. It has a part of its base, the Greek does, then the same stem. Greek words have a stem, and you build on them as to changing the meanings of them. So it has a part of its base, the same stem that makes up the Greek word that we translate into English as shameful. When is the last time you saw somebody ashamed of much of anything? Everything on television that in my day and age, when I was young, that my mama would have said, you ought to be ashamed of yourself for doing, is promoted today as the way to be. It is a terrible thing, to say the least. When little girls of 2, 3, 4, 5 years old are dressed like prostitutes on the street corner, and everybody says, oh, isn't she cute? No, she's not. Clothing conveys messages. Hairstyles even can convey a message. Back when the hippies first showed up, when I was about the age of most of them in the 60s. Never will forget Brother G.K. Wallace, who's been dead a long time now, stood up at the old Fried Hardeman College lectures and said, don't you know that all that long hair is nothing but a flag? A flag's an emblem. It declares the stance and the position. And of course, they didn't trust anybody over 30. Which nowadays, if those same people are alive, means they can't trust themselves. The ideal was rebellion. That was the whole thing behind it. Rebellion. Now, some of you much younger than that and came along after all of that stuff was accepted and had permeated and has permeated and become acceptable. You don't realize what it was like when it first made its advent in about the mid-60s. But we're going to be influenced in the way we think, say, and do, and who we associate with and how we dress, either by the world or by the teaching of the Word of God. And I tell you, the world passes away in the lust thereof, but the Word of God abides forever. So I know which one I'm going to let influence me because I've done it since I was a teenager. And I looked considerably different when I was 17 or 18 than I do now. But I still preach the same word. You know, I can even go back and pull some of my old sermon outlines when I was 18, 19, and 20. And because they are the rightly divided truth of the Bible, I preach them at 70 just like I did at 18. Because truth doesn't change. Jesus said, if you continue in my word, then are you my disciples indeed. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Meaning free from sin, free from the world. Well, I preached that back then. I've seen no reason to change it. It's from the infallible, the inerrant, the all-sufficient, final revelation of God to man. And it'll read that way and mean that way and mean those things when you stand before God in judgment. Shame is something that people need to know. You know, one place that you can, in fact, it's the, as the fellow said, the mainest place. The place where you need to start instilling shame in a person is mamas and daddies raising their children. Teaching their children by a proper standard what they ought to be ashamed of and what they ought to be happy with, what they ought to cultivate, what they ought to reject. This word is rarely used in classical Greek, and it references lascivious things, a word we don't use too much, but in our comments today, surely you know what we'd be referring to if I talk about lasciviousness. The phrase foolish talk is a translation of one Greek word, as we would bring it up to the use of our words today. It's a fairly straightforward and literal translation. In this context, it would be anything that might embroil one in a situation where one would be tempted to commit some kind of sexual sin. In other words, before the actual act, you sin by getting into a position that leads you into the act. This word also is only used this one time in the New Testament of our Lord, and its context would seem to define for us what it is referring to. All of that to get us down to, finally, the word jesting. Crude joking. Jesting. Crude joking. The word literally involves a turn of a phrase. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, in today's English, we refer to it as a double entendre. And something, it means where something seemingly innocent is said, but really it's the second meaning we're after, and that's usually sexual in nature. To quote from one commentator, Linsky, in page 596, he says, "The three may refer to speech. The last two certainly do so. And because of the context, these are given a sexual coloring. How worldlings so generally love nasty stories, throw out silly, vile remarks, crack supposed jokes of a spicy kind," unquote. And I must say, with Linsky's comments, we certainly agree. He has set out the meaning of the text. He has set out what God forbids a Christian to do. And in today's world, we are seemingly bombarded endlessly with nasty speech. It comes to us from our work environment, from various places where we socialize, certainly from our own television sets, especially the sitcoms that we see that are so popular and everybody loves. You know, even when they advertise those things, trying to get you to watch them all the time, they usually pick this kind of scene to where you have the double entendre as to advertise it, because that's what appeals to people. And there seems to be no end to the number of ways when you add the whole internet to the thing that men and women today can joke regarding the things that are only appropriate between a husband and a wife. Christians must, it's part of our preaching the gospel of the world, it's part of our contending for the faith. We must resolve to rid our minds of such thoughts. There's the beginning point. They're thoughts contrary to the will of heaven. They're thoughts that are not characteristic of a child of God. And we should have such thoughts removed completely in the sense that they never pass our lips. Now, it may be time something crosses our mind, but we can stop it right there and kick it out, because you are a person that has the will to do that. If you can will to retain good things, you can will to kick out the bad ones. Someone asked, and I've told this a long time ago, I don't think it's been lately, but somebody says, "Well, how do I keep those thoughts from influencing me?" And he told something an old Chinese philosopher had said. He said, I may not be able to stop birds from flying over my head, but I can stop them from building a nest in my hair." So you may not be able to cut yourself loose from everything around you. You're in the world. But you can, by your own will and love of God and His truth and wanting to be a Christian and all that that means, you can stop it. You can kick it out. Because you can know the Bible, the mind of Christ, and you can know when a thought crosses your mind that's contrary to the mind of Christ. And you can know these verses like this from the mind of Christ that tells us how we ought to be, how we must be, what is characteristic of Christian living and what is not. I say again, this is as needful as anybody can, as anything I can say, because when we go to preach the gospel to those out in the world who have no religious background, and there are more and more people like that, then we're going to have to deal on these things. They're going to have to see what God requires of them in living the Christian life. And thus, they need to be brought to repentance to understand you do these things, you cannot go to heaven. Notice this was written to members of the church at Ephesus. We probably in the New Testament have more knowledge of that one church than we do any other church in the first century. And we need to understand that God used those things in a very lascivious part of a world's history in the first century Roman Empire to teach us you can't do that. And the person who rises up and says, well, I just don't like, as I said in the beginning, people tell me I can't do this and I can't do that. But they're telling me I can't preach it. So see, it really comes down to this. I like to say you can't do it if it fits in with me. So you're really not opposed, I told one man, to saying, don't be negative. Because wherein you're negative, if everybody be negative with you, then you're very happy with that. Because that suits your purpose. So they really don't believe what they propagate and what they stand up and say when they say, don't be negative. And they really want to say, well, we just won't be negative. Just try to use the positive pole of your battery in your car and not use the negative pole and see how far the car goes. No, when you look in the Bible, Ten Commandments for the Jews and the Jewish economy, look and see how many of those Ten Commandments are negative. Then when you look at Paul saying, preach the word, be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort. Two-thirds of it's negative. People that say things like that, let me be kind about this, but let me be plain. They don't know what in the world they're talking about. They are ignorant. Now, Paul said, I would not have you ignorant, brethren. And I would not have you ignorant of what the Bible teaches on this matter of negative or what is involved according to God in living a faithful Christian life in this area of immorality. So Christians must resolve to rid their minds of such thoughts. And should we have such thoughts, I say again, never let them pass our lips, but rebuke them in our minds. If we win the battle of the minds, we won the battle of life and our conduct. And if we've been guilty of speaking in such a way in the past, then we need to strive to do better in this regard. To ever have a penitent mind and a conscience easily pricked when we see we've violated the will of heaven and willing to be repentant and confess our sins and pray God for forgiveness. This is how one grows in Christ. If you don't hold that disposition of mind towards your whole life as a member of the church, from the time you're baptized into Christ and rise from the watery grave as a new creature in Christ, you will not grow, and that means you will not go to heaven. You will fall away. Oh, you may continue to attend the worship. You may be active in that sense, but you won't be faithful. You'll be just like the world. Now, why does anybody want to be a member of the church and live like the world? Just stay in the world and live that way. But when you become a Christian and all that that means and the way one does it in believing in Christ based upon what the Bible teaches and proves that He's the Son of God, and you must, Romans 10:17, for faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. And when you're willing to truly repent and all that that means, Luke 13:3-5, and the command to obey after you've believed, Acts 17:30. And when you will confess your belief, confidence, and trust in Jesus Christ as the Son of God, now qualified to be buried with Him in baptism for the remission of your sins, raised to walk a new life, tell me how that life is new, how you're a new creature spiritually, when you're going to go right back and do the things you were doing, saying the things you were saying, and thinking the things you were thinking before you ever heard the gospel. Christians are the leavening of the world for good, the light of the world for good, only because we live a certain way. And that way is set out in the Bible as to what we should do and not do, how we should think and not think. Now, before ending our study, let us note one more matter. In contrast to this type of base humor, there's nothing wrong with humor that is instructive and decent in nature. But you have to know your Bible, the will of God, to know which is which. Now, we've seen what's condemned. This passage doesn't deal, though, with all kinds of humor. only with the kinds that involve matters of sexual promiscuity. For a Christian to tell a perfectly innocent joke to another Christian is often fun and can be instructive. I've seen many stories told that are basically jokes in a sermon that brought home a point of truth that people saw so clearly. So those things are not bad. They don't fit the condemnation that's placed upon these ideas and words of sexual promiscuity. So keep that in mind and understand what we're saying, what we're not saying, what the New Testament is teaching, and what it's not teaching. Are you a Christian this morning? And all of the New Testament defines the word Christian to be. That means a certain way of thinking, a certain way of life, and it means that you have obeyed the gospel as we just discussed it to become a Christian. Anybody who hasn't done that has not become a Christian. I don't care how pious they are or how much they claim belief in Christ, because he's the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him. You'll never find that Christ saves those who refuse to obey him, no matter how much they say, I believe in Christ. Well, you know what to do to become a Christian. As a child of God, have you been faithful? Have you been mindful of where you set your thoughts and the words you choose and how you let the world influence you? Spend much time in the study of the Bible, meditation on it, examining your life, much time in prayer, and be determined no matter which way the world goes, you're going to go the way the Bible teaches. If you need to repent of sins, God's second law of pardon requires this. To confess your sins, and we'll all pray with you and for you, then God will forgive. Now, I'm glad to tell everybody in time I preach, you can be what God wants you to be if you're willing to submit to what God wants you to submit to. You can be saved when you leave this building, or you can remain in your sin. You can determine to go right ahead and do as you please. But on the day of judgment, if you do that, you'll hear a call from the lips of he who would save you and gave his life to save you. Depart from me, the work iniquity, into everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. You don't want to hear that. And none of us who are Christians want you to hear it. But you must be willing to submit to his will so you won't hear it. So we ask you now to consider these things. In all honesty, as God searches your heart with you, would you respond to the gospel while we stand and sing?